Section 6.5, we're going to kind of continue to put some more stuff together as far as, you know, the whole factoring thing and kind of where we left off with Section 4, where we take a little bit more of a look at how, you know, what we're doing factoring relates to what your graphs are going to look like. All right, so this is one of those things where you're probably going to need to utilize a graphing calculator at some point in time. You know, when you're in class, that's not really much of an issue because I have some that you can use. When you're outside of class, there is a link to a graphing calculator website that I have on my particular website. If you go to the Algebra 2 tab on my website and go all the way to the bottom, you'll be able to find a link to that, which will really help you out when it comes to looking at these, when we're finding zeros and stuff like that. So we left off with, we were kind of factoring. We talked about three different ways we can more or less factor the other day. One of them being we can utilize synthetic division. Another one being we can go ahead and factor by grouping when we have more than three terms. We have four of them. We can go ahead and take a look at how that's going to work with grouping things together. And then the other one we talked about the other day was using the difference of cubes or sum of cubes formulas to go ahead and factor things. So now what we're going to do is we're going to take some of those ideas for factoring, specifically probably some of that synthetic division stuff, and we're going to start using those factoring methods to solve for zeros. But what we're going to do a little bit different than you know, kind of the way that some of these books recommend doing is I'm going to allow you the opportunity to graph some of these so you can look at the graphs and get a better idea of where it looks like the zeros might be. And with something like that, that helps you kind of zero in a little bit on what you can use as far as synthetic division is concerned. Okay, so a couple things we're going to look at here is what it means to have for a root to have multiplicity. Okay, and we're going to take a look at the rational root theorem and the irrational root theorem, and we're going to kind of explain what those mean as far as whether you have roots or zeros that are real numbers, or when you have roots or zeros that happen to be complex or have imaginary aspects to them. All right, now multiplicity is the main term that we're going to focus on here. And what we're talking about with multiplicity is before in Chapter 5, when we did some factoring, say you got to the point where you factored, your two factors were the same. I had x minus 2, x minus 2. You set those equal to 0, and you basically end up getting x equals 2, x equals 2. All right, well, what that really means is obviously we know your graph isn't going to intersect the x-axis twice at the same spot. Okay, before it was basically just looked more or less like it was touching at that spot. So we might have a parabola that came down and did something like that where we would say that was at 2 on the x-axis. All right. When you have a factor that appears twice after you factored something out, or a root that technically appears twice when you solve, that root is said to have multiplicity. In this case, the root x equals 2 would have a multiplicity of 2 because it appears twice when we go ahead and we factor things out. Okay, now that's a relatively simple example of how this works. What we're going to get into might be a little bit more complex than that, but that's the general idea. For every time that you have a factor show up that is the same in your factored result, you would say it has a multiplicity of that. Okay, now we usually don't worry about multiplicity of 1 because multiplicity of 1 simply means that we only have the factor there one time. But there are going to be situations that we're going to look at as far as looking at graphs where you can kind of get an idea of what the multiplicity of a root might be simply by looking at the graph. Okay, so I already talked about the previous lesson. We talked about different ways to factor. And if you go all the way back to lesson 5.3, all right, and you might not remember specifically what that was, but that's kind of where we started putting the factoring thing together with solving to find roots and solutions. All right, and basically all we're talking about with the zero product property is that if you set a particular polynomial equal to zero and you factor, and then you set each individual factor equal to zero, you can go ahead and solve for x and find those zeros or find those roots or the points at which the graph would cross the x-axis. Okay. Now, obviously, with imaginary numbers and stuff, when we have imaginary roots, we're not necessarily looking for points where we cross the x-axis, because imaginary roots are kind of floating out there in those in the imaginary or the complex plane. All right, but we get the general idea, and we're going to be focusing on real numbers for the first portion of this lesson anyway. Okay, now we're going to start off just by factoring here and then solving. Okay, now if you look at something here, we're going to approach it just like we would approach anything else. The first thing we look for is always, do they have something in common? Okay, well in this case, it looks like I can take out a 4, and I can also take out an x to the 4th, or that would be the greatest common factor of this particular trinomial. Then, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to write what I would have left if I take that out. So x squared looks like plus x minus 6. All right, then I'm going to focus on that part that's in parentheses. I'm still going to leave this out front here. But I should be able to factor that because it's just a basic quadratic trinomial now. Okay, going back to the chapter 5 stuff. So x and x looks like we're going to have different signs. Plus and minus, it looks like I need a 3 and a 2 to make sure we add up to that 1, positive 1x there. Okay, so now it'd be factored. And again, you can always FOIL, and you can even redistribute the 4x to the 4th. And if you do that, you should get back to what your original polynomial was, if you want to check to make sure that you're on the right track. And just like I always said back in Chapter 5, when we were talking about factoring quadratic equations, is there's really not an excuse to get anything wrong when you factor, because you can always check to make sure that everything works out by FOILing and distributing and so on and so forth. Okay, so here, technically I have 3 factors. I have to set all of them equal to 0. The 4x to the 4th, because it has a variable aspect to it, I set that equal to 0. I set x plus 3 equal to 0. And I set x minus 2 equal to 0. All right, well here, these are always pretty easy when you're taking that first monomial factor out in front and setting it equal to 0, because you're always going to get 0. There's only one thing that x could possibly be if you're supposed to get a result of 0, and that's 0. Okay, here I'm going to get x equals negative 3. Here I'm going to get x equals 2. Okay, now this is one of those things where I get 3 answers, and we're going to get to this a little bit more in the future as far as knowing how many possible answers you can get. But if you look at this, you always want to look at your highest power of x. All right, and this is, we're kind of referring to what's going to be called the fundamental theorem of algebra here in the future. But what 6 means is that the total possible number of roots that you can have for a particular polynomial is at maximum what the highest power is. So in this case, 6. All right. Now, the thing I want you to make sure you're aware of is that includes real number solutions and also complex and imaginary number solutions. Okay. So in this case, I get 3 different real number answers, which is what we're going to focus on right now. Okay. Which means that I could possibly have maybe another 3. Okay, another 3 that could be complex or imaginary. Or even if you look at something like this, this factor out in front, it is possible that that monomial factor maybe has some multiplicity to it. So technically, if it would be there a few more times, that would account for some of the other solutions that would possibly add up to our maximum of 6 that we could possibly have. But again, that's just kind of a real brief introduction to what we're going to talk about in the next section with the fundamental theorem of algebra. Okay, so just remember, it is possible to get that many solutions as you go through this. Now, basically what we would see, and I included a graph of this on the next slide, is you have something that comes down, comes back up, down, and back up. Okay, now as far as how far down it goes, it's kind of hard to tell. All right, but you can see distinctly, it looks like we are crossing the x-axis in 3 places, negative 3, 0, and 2. So we've taken care of all our real number solutions. Now, where these graphs happen to turn down at the bottom, usually that's an indication that you have a imaginary an imaginary root down there somewhere. And at the same time, if portion of your graph touches the x-axis but never crosses it, usually that's an indication that that particular root has a multiplicity of 2. Okay, so if you think about that, you know, we have 1, 2 roots being negative 3 and 2, plus we touch right here at 0, so technically that would account for 2 because it has a multiplicity of 2, which would put us up to 4. And then the points down here where your graph bends would be imaginary solutions. Okay, so we'd be looking at 6 total roots if we include both real and imaginary complex solutions. Okay, but again, that's kind of foreshadowing what we're going to talk about in the next section. All right, here's another example. Again, with factoring, you're just going to want to make sure that you have everything in standard form. Or, you know, standard form we talked about with quadratics. Here we just need to make sure we have standard form is kind of one of those things where you have the highest power first on down to the constant. Now, this one's a little bit different, and that's part of the reason I included it here. You don't necessarily have anything they have in common you can take out. So because I have an even power here and an even power here, I'm going to kind of treat it as if this was kind of like an x squared and this was an x. So I'm going to go ahead and try to factor with two sets of parentheses. So to get x to the fourth, I'm going to think x squared and x squared. I need to get this to add up to 26, and then my signs are both going to be the same, and they're both negative. So I'm going to go ahead and say that I'm going to put a 25 in one of these, and I'm going to put a 1 in the other one. That'll get me to add up to that 26, negative 26 in the middle. Now, I need to be careful, because I have x squareds and stuff, that I can't still factor what's inside these parentheses. And in this case here, they're both difference of squares. So I'm actually going to end up with x plus 5, x minus 5, and then x plus 1, x minus 1. All right, so when I take all that stuff and set it equal to 0, I get negative 5, 5, negative 1, and 1. So essentially, I have 4 real number roots or real number solutions. And again, our highest power was 4. All right, so it is possible to get 4 solutions. Okay, meaning my graph would probably intersect, not probably, it would intersect the x-axis in four different spots. Okay? And in this case here, we would have no imaginary solutions that would go with this. Okay? So that's just another example of how you can factor and use that type of method to go ahead and find roots of your polynomial equation. All right? Now, we've kind of already talked about this a little before as far as multiplicity and what it is. And even on the first example where we factored, I kind of talked about how that 0 was going to have a multiplicity of 2, so that can account for one of your roots there. Okay? So basically what we're talking about again is when you factor something out, if factors repeat themselves, that means that particular root, when you solve, has a multiplicity. Okay? Sometimes it's not real easy to tell when you factor. Or sometimes it's tough to get to a point where you can factor, where you can actually go ahead and tell what roots are going to have multiplicity or be able to figure that out. The graph can help you out a little bit, okay? And there's two different instances here if you kind of read through what's on this particular slide that will help you out. But as we move to the next graph here, the next slide that has a graph on it, what you're looking for with multiplicity, okay, is if the graph, as it does right here, approaches the x-axis and then only touches it and turns around, that means that that root is going to have a multiplicity of 2. Okay? On the other hand, if you look at what's over here, if your graph crosses the x-axis, but it kind of bends, like it's bending right in here, okay, that means it's going to have a multiplicity of, technically you'd say 1 or 3, but more times than not it's going to be 3. Okay, so if it bends, it's going to have a multiplicity of 3. Okay, so if it goes straight through, it's just going to have a multiplicity of 1. We don't worry about that a whole lot. Okay, if it hits and then turns but never actually crosses, okay, it's going to have a multiplicity of 2. And if it goes through and bends, like this example on the right here, all right, that means it's going to have a multiplicity of 3. Okay, now, what that can help you out with a little bit is helping to determine how something can be factored. If you have something that's a little more complex and might not look like it can easily be factored. Okay, now, the next slide here says identify the roots of each equation, state the multiplicity of each root. All right, now, the reason I included the graph with this is the graph is kind of your best friend here. This is something where it has 4 terms. My polynomial has 4 terms. And if you look at it, factoring it is probably not going to work out very well. Okay? So what we'd be looking at is, I'm going to go ahead and look at the graph. Okay, it looks like the graph says that it's going to intersect around negative 2. So one approach I could take to this would be, all right, I know negative 2 has to be a root, and based on the graph, we're bending as we go through negative 2. So what that means is that more than likely negative 2 has a multiplicity of 3, which would make sense here with 3 being my highest power in my polynomial. But I'm going to use synthetic division to kind of help show how all this is going to work. All right? So I'm going to drop the 1, negative 2, I'm going to get 4, negative 8, I'm going to get 4, and I'm going to get negative 8, and I'm going to get 0. So that, in fact, does mean that x plus 2 is a factor, because my root, or my number that I put in here, was negative 2, so that means x plus 2 was a factor. All right, and that leaves me with x squared plus 4x plus 4 if I go ahead and I look at my coefficients that are left on the bottom. Now, because it looks like from the graph that this is going to have multiplicity, all right, that means that this part should probably still be factorable. Now, I could go ahead and take negative 2 and use synthetic division and fill this part in right here and do synthetic division, but because it's down to the point where it's now a quadratic, I can go ahead and look at it, and I should probably be able to factor that. X and X, plus and plus, looks like 2 and 2. All right, with the original factor I had there. So you can see how the graph in synthetic division helps you get to a point where you can maybe factor something in more of a traditional sense without having to use synthetic division over and over again. Okay, and if you see this, because I have x plus 2, x plus 2, x plus 2 listed 3 times, that means my root of x equals negative 2, which we already talked about right in here, has a multiplicity of 3. Okay, and again, that 3 would account for the 3 possible answers or possible roots I could get for something of that nature. Okay, again, here's another example of something where we have more than 3 terms, and factoring this, you know, you could try to factor by grouping again, but it doesn't look like grouping these and grouping these, when we start factoring out of those individual groups, we're going to be able to get a whole lot that really helps us. So I'm going to go ahead and use the graph to help me out. Looks like negative 3 over here is going to be a possible solution. And over here, it looks like positive 1 is going to be a viable option as well. Okay, now, we just need to make sure that we test these out a little bit. We can't just go strictly based on what the graph tells us. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and it actually looks like the negative 3 is going to have a multiplicity probably of 3. Okay, or maybe it's even 1. We'll have to see what happens here. And it looks like we're going to have a root that's over at positive 1. So I'm going to go ahead and start with the negative 3 as a possibility here. So list my coefficients and my constant. Okay, I'm going to synthetic division with negative 3 because it looks like it's where my graph crosses. So 1, negative 3, 5, negative 15, 3. Oh, did I do something wrong there? Drop the 1, get negative 3, 5. Oh, that's my problem. In here, I don't have an x term. So I should have put a 0 in there. That's my fault. So I'd get a negative 9 here. Alright, so that would give me negative 9 when I drop down, and then 27, and a remainder of 0. Okay, so again, I made one of the most common mistakes you have there is we're missing an x term, so I need to make sure I include that 0 in there as I go. Okay, so what that's telling me, based on what I already thought, is x plus 3 is a factor, and that would go ahead and leave me with x to the third plus 5x squared plus 3x minus 9. Okay, now again, I'm still at something x to the third. It doesn't look like grouping that part would work again, so I'm probably going to do synthetic division over again. And I'm going to use negative 3 again because it looks like it's going to have multiplicity based on this bend here. So I'm going to go ahead and say 1, 5, 3, and negative 9 would be my coefficients, okay, because that's what I ended with up here. All right, 1, negative 3, 2, negative 6, negative 3, 9, and you get 0. Okay, so what that means again for us is x plus 3 is a factor at least twice. And that would leave me with x squared plus 2x minus 3. Okay, and again, that's based on what I have left down here on the bottom. Now, I'm to the point where it's an x squared. I'm going to go ahead and just try to factor this. X looks like plus 3 minus 1. Plus I have those original two factors I got from synthetic division. All right, so you can see my roots technically would be x equals negative 3 if I were to go ahead and set all of these equal to 0 and solve, and x equals 1. Okay, now the only thing I'd have to make sure include is this x minus 3 has a multiplicity of 3, okay, which is evident based on those three factors being right there. Okay, and the x equals 1 technically has a multiplicity of 1. All right, so again, there's kind of some work involved in there, but you can see it's not necessarily that difficult. I know most of us are pretty good with synthetic division, and just kind of understanding how the graph really helps us out a lot when we're trying to go ahead and figure out where to get started. Okay, now, the next thing here is not all polynomials are going to be factorable, but what's called the rational root theorem can help us find possible roots of a polynomial equation. Okay, so what this is saying is, if a polynomial has integer coefficients, okay, or basically just coefficients that are in the positives or the negatives, then every rational root of the polynomial equation can be written in the form P over Q, where P is a factor of the constant term and Q is a factor of the leading coefficient. All right. So what this is going to do, and we're still going to use graphs to help us out, even though some books don't necessarily do things that way, we're going to use graphs to help us out because there are some cases where you can get a whole slew of numbers and possible rational roots. And it's too confusing to have to guess and check with all of them, so we're still going to use the graph to help us out. Now, we're going to lead with a story problem here just because we want to fix it and, you know, get it in the mix here a little bit. Okay, so what this says is the design of a box specifies that its length is 4 inches greater than its width. The height is 1 inch less than the width, and the volume of the box is 12 cubic inches. Okay, what is the width of the box? Well, first and foremost, volume equals length times width times height. Okay, well, I don't know the width, so the width is going to be my variable. I'm going to call the width x. All right, so it says the length is 4 inches greater than the width. So the width plus 4 would be that aspect of it. Okay, the height is 1 inch less, so the width minus 1 would be the height. All right, and we already said that the width is going to be x. So the width, the length, excuse me, width, length, height, all represented together. And that's supposed to give us basically a volume of 12. So to go ahead and figure out an equation here, if we want to solve for x, We have to multiply everything together. All right, so essentially, figuring out that part is going to lead us to something that we can use here, and then go ahead and show how the rational root theorem is going to work for us. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and FOIL this inside part. So x squared is going to be minus 1x plus 4x, so plus 3x. And then I'm going to get minus 4. And then I have to go ahead and distribute. So x to the third plus 3x squared minus 4x is going to equal 12. And then again, to make this work, the whole idea is we have to set things equal to 0. Okay? So it's something like this. All right? Now, what we're going to do here, and I'm going to go ahead and just graph this on my graphing calculator while I'm kind of talking here a little bit, just so we get the, I can kind of draw it by hand there, what our graph should look like, because the graph is going to help us out here in the long run a little bit as far as what's going to help us when we get some possible roots here. So it looks like something along these lines down is what our graph is going to look like, where it looks like this is at roughly 2. This is roughly negative 3, and this is roughly negative 2. Okay? Now, I didn't include a graph with the actual the PowerPoint to begin with, but you know, if you had to graph that on your own, again, just graphing this on your own, you'd kind of be able to tell what's going on here. All right, now, what we're looking at is we're trying to figure out possible roots that can make this work. Now, obviously, if I look at the graph, it looks like negative 3, negative 2, and 2 would probably be my roots, okay? But what I need to do is I need to think about what the rational root theorem just said. It said if I look at this right here, okay, my possible factors would be, I want to look at all factors of 12, okay, or negative 12, which would basically be plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2, plus or minus 3, plus or minus 4, plus or minus 6, and plus or minus 12. Okay, so that would be what it referred to as P on the last graph. Okay, then Q would be whatever our leading coefficient. Well, our leading coefficient is 1, so I'm just looking at plus or minus 1. So what that means is all possible roots, or anything that could be a possible root, would be by taking P and dividing it by Q. Okay, so literally what I would have to do is take all of these numbers up here for P, plus 1, minus 1, plus 2, minus 2, and divide them all by 1, and then divide them all by negative 1. So basically, anything that's listed up here for P, because we'd be dividing them by 1 and negative 1, would be possible roots. Now, it becomes a little bit more difficult when your leading coefficient is something other than 1, all right? But this is just kind of something to get us started with that. So basically, my possible roots would be plus 1, minus 1, plus 2, minus 2, plus 3, minus 3, all the way to plus 12, all right? Because dividing all of these by 1 or negative 1 is just going to leave me with the same stuff I already have written up there. Okay, now, if you didn't have a graph, that would make things really difficult because you would have to go ahead and fill everything into synthetic division and try to see how you can make it work. Okay, but because I graphed something up there, all right, it looks like all of these up here are possibilities based on what the rational root theorem is telling me. Okay, so I can pick one of those values, all right, and I can go ahead and do synthetic division, and I can go ahead and figure out what my possible answers would be. Okay, so what I'm looking at here is, okay, let's pick 2. So I'm going to do 2 with synthetic division. We got 1, 3, negative 4, negative 12 are my coefficients of this guy down here. So 1, 2, 5, 10, 6, 12, 0. Okay, so again, what that means is x minus 2 is a factor, which would leave me with x squared plus 5x plus 6. Okay, equal to 0 if we wanted to go that route. Now, again, I've worked it down to where I use synthetic division to help me find the first root or the factor. And now I can see that this part up here is a quadratic, so I should be able to factor it kind of on my own. So I'm going to do that over here on the side. Looks like I'm going to get x and x, and more than likely I should get plus 3 plus 2, which it is what it looks like, based on what I got up here. Okay, so that means that x minus 2, x plus 3, and x plus 2 would be my factors. And that means that, like I said up here on the graph, negative 3, negative 2, and 2 would all be my roots. Okay, so what we're looking at here is, you know, what is the width of my box? Okay, well, more than likely, it'd be one of those things where we kind of have to go ahead and take a look at, this one is my width right here. Okay, so if I want to find the width of my box, I have to figure out which one of those answers, you know, would best work with what I have going on here. Now think about this. Negative 3, negative 2, and 2 were my answers. Is it possible to have a negative length or negative width in this case? And the answer to that is no. So of my three zeros I got, negative 3, negative 2, and 2, 2 is the only possible one that would make sense because it's the only positive value. And again, that's what this question is asking you. All right. Now, that was the rational root theorem, just allowing us to find possible values that could work. There's also an irrational root theorem. And basically what it comes down to is you would use the irrational root theorem after you use synthetic division and say you're left with a quadratic and you can't factor it. So more than likely, you'd end up having to use the quadratic formula. And when you use the quadratic formula, you'd end up with some imaginary solutions. All right, well, what this is telling you is just simply, if a plus some imaginary number is a root or a solution, that means that a minus that would also happen to be a solution. Okay? And that's just stating that to help you out. And it's not necessarily a big deal here. It's one of those things in the future, especially when we get into the fundamental theorem of algebra, that's going to make a lot more sense, and it's going to really help you eliminate things and narrow things down a lot quicker. Okay, now this is just giving a better example of how that works. Basically, what it's saying is if you know that 1 plus the square root of 2 is a root, that means that 1 minus the square root of 2 is a root. Okay, so the irrational root theorem. Okay, and I guess I should say, on the last one, I mentioned imaginary numbers. Technically, we're not into that yet. We could say, you know, the same thing exists. If 1 plus 2i is a solution, that means 1 minus 2i has to be an imaginary root of what's going on, too. Irrational, we're just talking about here, square root of 2 is an irrational number, you know, a decimal that goes on forever. So if you have those as solutions, like I said, if 1 plus the square root of 2 is a solution, you wouldn't even have to process anything else or fill anything else out to know that 1 minus the square root of 2 is also a solution. Okay? Now, that kind of leads us to our last thing here, okay, where you're supposed to identify all real roots of a polynomial equation. So this might include whole numbers, like we've had before, but it could also possibly include irrational numbers where we have square roots and stuff, and I'll kind of talk about how we're going to find that here. So again, I'd want to go ahead and take a look at what I have up here on the board for my given polynomial to start with. Okay, now, rational root theorem says I'm going to worry about finding all rational numbers first and kind of compare that to my graph down here. So this would be my p, and this would be my q if I think about the rational root theorem from the last slide. Okay, possible factors of 2 over here would be plus or minus 1 and plus or minus 2. Okay, likewise, Okay, for Q, so this is P. For Q, I'd have the same thing. Plus or minus 1 and plus or minus 2 are my factors of 2. So what I'd be looking at here is all the possible roots that I can have that are rational numbers involve taking P divided by Q. So if I take 1 or negative 1 and divide it by 1 or negative 1, that means I'm going to get plus or minus 1. Okay? If I take plus or minus 1 and divide it by plus or minus 2, that means I'm going to get plus or minus 1 half. And if I take 2, plus or minus 2, and divide it by plus or minus 1, I'm going to get plus or minus 2. Okay, so again, I'm just taking all these up here and dividing them by all the q's. And then the last one would be plus or minus 2 divided by plus or minus 2. Well, that's just going to give me plus or minus 1 again, so I don't have to worry about anything else. So those three that are listed over here are all the possible roots that I could have, possible rational roots, like whole numbers and fractions that I could have. Okay, so now I want to look down here at my graph. Okay, that I already starred. Based on this graph, I want to look at the possible rational numbers that I have up there. Plus or minus 1, plus or minus 1 half, and plus or minus 2. And I want to see if it looks like any of those show up on my graph. And it looks like in here, that's about 1 half. So that's what I'm going to start with here. I'm going to use 1 half in synthetic division. Okay, so 2, negative 9, we're missing that x term, and I have a 2. So I'm going to drop the 2. 1 half times 2 gives me 1. All right, so I'm going to get negative 8. Then I'm going to get negative 4. And then I'm going to get negative 2. Okay, so it looks like I guessed right based on what was going on there. Okay, so there's a couple different ways you can probably write this if you're talking about factors. All right, we know this is a root. We know x equals 1 half is a root, and that would be this one right here. Okay, as far as factors go, you could write it as x minus 1 half equals 0, you know, or x minus 1 half. We're actually going to write it more of what it would look like. It should be 2x minus 1, technically, because if you were to set that equal to 0, you would add 1 and divide by 2. All right, then what would be left here? 2x squared minus 8x minus 4. Now, here's the kicker with this whole deal. Okay? Because it doesn't look like any of these other rational possibilities show up on my graph, then more than likely, this is not factorable. You know, for right now, it looks like we could probably take a 2 out of everything. All right, so we could go ahead and do that, and I'll just write it out in front of everything. All right, x squared minus 4x minus 2, okay, which this should give you a little better look as to, okay, that's probably not going to be factorable here. Okay, the leftover isn't factorable. All right, so what that means is I have to think of an alternative way to go ahead and try to solve for my other solutions. Now, you probably have a couple options here. You could complete the square, or you could use the quadratic formula, okay? And most of us know how to use the quadratic formula. I'm going to go ahead and just complete the square because I think that might be a little bit simpler with this one right here. Okay, equals 0. So what I need to do is x squared minus 4x. I'm going to put the 2 on the other side. We're going to half the 4, or half the negative 4, which is negative 2. Square it, we're going to get 4. So plus 4. Put plus 4 on the other side. I made this a perfect square trinomial. X minus 2 equals 6. Okay? Square root both sides. X minus 2 is going to equal, I suppose I should draw the square root in there, plus or minus the square root of 6. If I add the 2 over, x is going to equal 2 plus or minus the square root of 6. Okay, so what that means for us right there is that I do have technically two more solutions or two more roots, which you can actually see those on the graph right here. Okay, this one looks like it would be 2 plus the square root of 6, and this one is 2 minus the square root of 6, okay, which I represented in here with just a plus or minus sign. Okay, so you still have three roots, And there's still technically three real number roots, okay? It's just the fact that the last two happen to have an irrational number attached to them, okay? So the main thing here is you're not always going to be able to factor what's left over after you do synthetic division, so you might have to use alternative methods. Now, my guess would be that most of us are probably going to go ahead and use the quadratic formula. I didn't here because I thought completing the square was easier, but if you would have used the quadratic formula, you still would have got to the same thing that we have right there. Okay, so identifying all the real roots, basically I identified all of them down here on the graph. Technically, if you wanted to write things factored out, you could say 2x minus 1, which I already had written over there, and then we could say x minus 2 minus the square root of 6, and then I could say x minus 2 plus the square root of 6. Okay, that would be the full factored version of all that stuff. Okay, but you probably don't have to worry about that so much. That's just what it would look like if you went that far. All right, now for simplicity's sake and the fact that I've really already talked a whole ton here, you can go ahead and try to work this one out. I'm not going to work it out up here, but trying to think here. The answers to this one, and see if you can get to come up with this, would be negative 1/2 and then 1 plus or minus the square root of 5. So if you use the same approaches and the same methods that I just used on the previous slide, you should be able to come up with those. Okay, again, figuring this one out here is a matter of using the whole P divided by Q thing and then using the graph over here to try to get a general idea to see that, okay, it looks like it intersects over here at about negative 1/2. Okay, and this one over here is too tough to tell, and you probably wouldn't have a possible root come from the P divided by Q thing to be able to tell. Okay, so give that one a try and see what you come up with. Maybe we'll start class with that the next time we meet to kind of see how far we came on that. Now, I realize this was quite time consuming. Hopefully you split this up into some breaks a little bit so you could kind of focus in on the stuff. It's not super complicated. It's just one of those things where each problem tends to take, you know, a fair amount of time because there's so many steps and so many different processes involved with it. Okay, just make sure you focus a lot on, or hopefully you did focus a lot on, what the graphs mean and how the graphs translate into different factors and different roots, and how using the graphs can really help you narrow down how your process of synthetic division is going to work for you. Okay, if you can do that, you should be okay as far as keeping everything straight. Okay, I realize there's going to be questions that you come up with as you go through this, but go back. Hopefully you took some good notes as you went through this, wrote down, you know, some of the sample problems that we went through together, so you have something to refer back to in the end, and it'll make this process a whole lot easier.